right, so I'm going to start this off with a question. How many people in this room work with people who are, I don't like to say overweight, I'm going to say obese. How many people in this room, raise your hand, I want to see it. I suspect your reaction to what I'm going to say is going to be very different than the individuals who don't work with individuals who are obese on a regular basis. And I'm not meant to, you know, condemn anybody, but I think that does impact how you view these things. And I've been very fortunate in that my first professional years were under Steve Blair at a place which was exercise, 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 exercise. Then I moved to a place led by Claude Bouchard, which was weight loss, weight loss, weight loss, weight loss. So I've had the rare opportunity to work with both camps, and I think maybe learn a thing or two from both camps, which I think has really shaped my views. And I want to make the point, these are my views. This is my talk and my opinions. And I get it. Not all you're going to agree with me. You're not supposed to. That's the beauty of the world. But this is my opinion. And I strongly believe that the AMA announcement last year, whatever you want to call it, that obesity is a disease, is a good thing. And I'm going to lay out today why I think it's a good thing. Indeed, I am a professor at Pennington Biomedical Research Center. You know, I made this slide 4 months ago. Never discussed religion, politics, or money at a party, or obesity. Well, Saturday night, I'm having dinner with my wife. She says, well, what are you going to talk about in Orlando? I said, I'm going to explain that obesity is a disease. She says, well, why do you do that? That's stupid. It's not a disease. So I laid out my argument for her, and she said, you're wrong. So there you go. It is a polarizing topic. For a variety of reasons. Now, I want to list my disclosures and conflicts, and I think I have a whole lecture on this because I think it's comical what's going on and the idea that conflicts and listing them changes people's behavior. Show me the published study. But I want to be a good citizen, so I do it. But when you have disclosures and you have conflicts, you have three options. One, simply don't list anything, which the majority of people do, and it's comical to me because we all have conflicts, even if they don't involve money. It's our job to have opinions and have conflicts. Two, list every company that ever supported any talk or any conference or any flight or anything you ever did. Good luck with that. Three, do the best you can. Do the best you can and as accurately as possible, and what will happen to you is you will get called out for your inaccuracies and you'll be chastised for being honest. So here's my disclosures. I work half my time at Pennington, the other half of my time is in commercial America. I interface with commercial America, so I'm going to have a lot of conflicts. The beautiful thing about my conflicts related to this talk is half these people think obesity is a disease, and half these people don't think obesity is a disease. So no matter what, I'm going to piss half of them off. This is the foundation of the talk. This is where I want you guys to understand where I'm coming from. We're not talking about weight gain prevention. We're talking about weight loss. The horse is out of the barn. Weight loss. Prevention is a whole other topic for a whole other day. This is not about exercise versus weight loss. In any way, shape, or form, this is not comparing and contrasting the two at all. This is strictly about weight loss. And further, I trained in public health. I'm trained in population medicine. I try to live by the idea of doing the most good for the most people. And that is where my argument begins. We want to do the most good for the most people here. This isn't about an academic fist fight and having beers afterwards and shaking hands. This is about trying to make a bunch of people healthier when there's options to do so. So the outline, one, path to my views. Two, obesity is a disease. I guess I'm obligated to talk about physiology, so I will attempt to. I will compare it to other disease states. Diabetes, which is to me where the whole argument comes down to, is diabetes. And then what to do as an exercise person, because I think that's important. I actually think there's a lot of opportunity here for individuals who work in exercise. So around 2001, I was on the Today Show because Dr. Blair was probably off in China and they needed someone else, so they asked me to do it. And I was asked to argue that obesity is a disease. And I did. And my argument was, this is purely a behavioral issue. Purely behavior. Further, we have a bigger issue. It's called inactivity. And we should be focusing on that. And it's more important from a public health perspective. And lastly, it's going to label too many people. And there's some things in there I still believe, but boy, times have changed. I had a reporter call me. He wanted me to argue this point. And I said, why would I argue that point? And they said, well, you did in 2000. I said, well, that was 20 years ago. You know, things have changed. My views began to change when we set up the Cooper Institute Weight Loss Clinic. It was expensive. It was extremely comprehensive. The behavioral coaching was so over the top. It was so well done. And we had relatively motivated patients paying a fair amount of money to be there. And they worked so hard. I mean, we put them through the ringer with some of the best behavioral coaching you could ever have. And at the end of the day, success was 10% weight loss. And it was for me, it was enlightening to witness these people go from 300 pounds to 270 pounds. We call this a clinical success, but have we really changed their lives? That didn't impact me as much as the heterogeneity. It's unreal to me how you can have 20 individuals in a class, and you know they're all working hard. You know it. And there's two or three of them that are going to lose 100 pounds without even trying. And then you're going to have two or three which just barely lose anything, and the rest are going to lose that 8 to 10% and maybe keep it off. The issue, it's two issues. One is the heterogeneity. I don't think we have enough of an appreciation for how different individuals respond to anything. We do with medications. Oh, that blood pressure medication didn't work. No big deal. We're going to give you this one instead. But we don't when it comes to the stuff we do with exercise and weight loss. And someone brought that up in John Jakasik's great lecture yesterday. And I think that's a really important point. And it's a dangerous issue because we take those super achievers and we put them on Oprah and we say, this is what everybody who's obese should be able to do. And it's unrealistic. We're setting a standard which is guaranteed to fail, which I think ultimately hurts everybody. So we create these crazy standards because of the super outliers. And what I took away from all this is that the weight loss process from a behavioral perspective, it's not easy and it's not fair. People who work really, really hard lose some weight. And yes, they're healthier, I get it. But not as much as you would think, given how much they've put into that. And I'm gonna suspect that the people out there in the audience who work with truly clinically obese individuals, very few of you are gonna argue with me. And you can later, but not right now. The second thing that really kind of changed my thinking was the Drew study. And I'm not gonna go too much into it. The Drew study, of course, was a dose response exercise study. All exercise was supervised. We know every step, every calorie. They did it with us. It was a phenomenal team effort. 464 women. You either got essentially 70 minutes a week or 135 minutes, 190 minutes a week in a control group. 91% of individuals completed the study. The only people we lost were people who had major life events. We had 98%, 97% exercise compliance across the groups. This is not a compliance issue. And lastly, we monitored what they did outside so we know they didn't become marathoners when they weren't hanging out with us. In fact, nothing changed. Their steps did not change. We've seen this in every study we've conducted where we measured outside activity. It just simply doesn't change. So when you look at thrust to validity, we had very small dropout. We had outstanding compliance both to the exercise prescription and to the outside activity. So when we're talking about weight, a lot of the things you normally interject into the discussion can't be interjected because we can say we took care of that. And we saw this real nice dose response change in fitness. The more you do, the more you benefit. The cool thing that, since we're talking about worth noting, is what look, 72 minutes a week of walking at very low intensity improves fitness. I mean, that's a great message. But this is where it got weird. I just show you that dose response. This wasn't a weight loss trial. This was an exercise trial. But understand, every woman in this trial came into it to lose weight. No matter how much we talked to them, that's why they were there. So we see this nice dose response on pretty much everything except weight. This is what we see for weight. And because we measured every calorie, we were kind of able to calculate. At the time, we thought we were really smart, using the 3,500 calories equals a pound, which now ends up is pretty much fiction. But nonetheless, we can make our point. The black bars are the predicted weight loss. The white bars are the actual weight loss. But you see, the 73-minute a week group lost about what they should have. The 136-minute a week group lost what they should have. The group that did approximately 200 minutes a week, a common recommendation for weight loss, by the way, lost half of what they should have. And you're thinking, well, this is an anomaly. Maybe your scales just don't work. We also measured them every week as part of their exercise. We saw the exact same thing. So we got duplicate data here. We've reproduced this thing many times. The inflame study, which had an even higher exercise dose, considerably higher, saw even more compensation. Once again, heterogeneity. This is the weight loss for each participant graphed for the 193 minute a week group. This is the stuff we know they were compliant. I already showed you that. You've got individuals way out on the right that actually gained weight during the trial. Now, it wasn't many, but it happened. You got individuals way on the left that lost a whole bunch of weight. Awesome. They were very exercise sensitive. Then you got a whole bunch in the middle that did a whole lot of nothing. This, to me, is so important. And in a way, it's the future. How do we identify those people on the right who aren't going to benefit, and what should we be doing with them? How do we identify those people on the left who are going to be hyper responders and tell them, heck yeah, run with this? When you think about a mean and how meaningless a mean is, when you look at this actual data, this is once again where it got me thinking, man, this weight loss thing, this is a lot more complicated than we're giving it credit for. It's not just calories in, calories out. It is, but there's other overriding things. So I want to transition to the physiology of weight loss, because if you're going to get up here and talk about, you know, why weight loss should be a disease, you're expected to talk about this. And it is so mind-bogglingly complicated. You think about the GI tract. The GI tract has more neurons than the human brain. And those neurons produce a whole lot of chemicals that do a whole lot of things. And we don't really think about that. We usually only think about them, and they interact with the feeding centers. And I want to give one example. This was a New England Journal paper. And what they looked at was the incretins, the hormones produced by the guts in response to weight loss. These are hormones which have dramatic effects on your eating. And so they put individuals into a behavioral weight loss trial. What you see here is they lost the weight. The maximal weight loss was about 18 weeks or so. And then, of course, like we always see, over time, the weight came back. And they did these really nice feeding studies where they looked at the hormones that come out of the gut that drive how we eat. And what they saw, to make a long story short, was after they lost the weight, the hormones moved the right direction, but then they came back up on their own, driving eating. To summarize it, the hormones that reduce hunger actually decrease, the leptin, the PYY, the CCK, the insulin, and the amylin. The hormones that increase appetite increased. They lost a bunch of weight. There was a hormonal response to increase eating and put that weight back on. How can you blame a person for that? And I guarantee you, if they had even more participants, you would see there's probably huge heterogeneity across these responses. And they've probably written that paper, and I just haven't seen it. Now, I want to talk about some things that I do not think are particularly relevant about this discussion, and that is obesity and food addiction. Are there some people addicted to food? Oh, heck yeah. But for anybody who's ever dealt with addiction, had a loved one, worked with people who were addicted, I find this a little bit condescending when we say that the obesity epidemic is being driven by addiction. Addiction is a powerful, powerful clinical term. And it absolutely applies to some individuals. I'm not arguing that. It is not driving our obesity epidemic. And I hear that all the time, like, man, you're just missing the point on this. Yeah, we got a lot of good tasting food, but we don't have a bunch of America. And I'm sorry, this is a horrible parallel. But if we were that weak as human beings, wouldn't we all be addicted to sex? I mean, it's a much more powerful drive than eating. So the assumption that food is driving the obesity epidemic through addiction doesn't make any sense to me. And please don't tell me about animal studies. You breed the animal the right way. There's a place for it. Brain imaging studies give me a headache. I think it's interesting. I think one day it's going to be great stuff. I think right now it's really expensive cross-sectional data. And every time I see a brain imaging study and I think it's really cool and I think there's something there, a brain imaging expert explains to me why it's bogus. And it scares me how much credit a lot of the brain imaging studies are getting right now for, to me, cross-sectional studies of ends of six and ends of eight. So I don't make the arguments obesity is disease because it's addictive or because of brain imaging. And that's I think that's semi-important. The foundation of my argument is follow the money. That's why I think it's important that we consider obesity a disease. Yes, there are many, many, many complications that we can claim are due to obesity. And we can argue which ones are due to obesity and which ones are due to physical activity, but that's not why I'm here, because the only one I care about is diabetes. We all, you know, we have to show these maps every time we give this talk. It's a law, or we don't get invited back. And up top, we've got the obesity epidemic. You've all seen it. CDC does a wonderful job with each year. Some of you, probably not all of you, have seen on the bottom the diabetes epidemic. We've had this obesity epidemic in parallel. We're having this diabetes epidemic. Another way of looking at it is right here. As long as we've been tracking type 2 diabetes, it's been hanging out at 3 to 4%. It was kind of this thing that when you saw it as a doctor, you're like, wow, I got a type 2 diabetic. That's interesting. It wasn't like blood pressure or dyslipidemia, where it was an everyday occurrence. And you see what's been going on. And what's so interesting about this, or scary, I should say, is that this epidemic is 10 years behind the obesity epidemic. I think the curve's going to actually steepen, because I think people entering adulthood are in far worse physical shape and have lower fitness that's ever entered, like what we're seeing with the military before. So I think not only is this going to continue for 10 years, but it's going to steepen. I personally think diabetes, Alzheimer's, we could probably name some other, are the greatest challenges facing our nation right now. Now, you're going to say, well, what about fit fat? You've argued before that fitness is far more important than fatness. I have. And I was right about death. When it comes to cardiovascular disease, once you've got diabetes, I am a firm believer that fitness and exercise is critical. And yes, I'm going to say probably more important than weight loss, unless we're talking about extreme levels of weight loss, unless we're talking about bariatric surgery. I'm going to stick to my guns on that. I'm going to further go on to say I think fitness, and low fitness in particular, is the most under-researched, underappreciated variable there is. It's more important than smoking. It's more important than uncontrolled diabetes. And we don't seem to care about the mechanisms, and I don't get it. And having, yes, I'm bitter. I've submitted a million grants around this, and not nearly as should get funded as I should. When it comes to developing diabetes, I think it's a different story. This is Nurses Health, and the bottom line is weight does make a difference. It makes a big difference. And you're thinking, but what, they looked at physical activity. They didn't look at fitness. It's not the same thing. Well, you use the same database we did for fit fat in men, fit fat in women. We put May's work up here. Weight makes a difference. I will argue when it comes to developing type 2 diabetes, weight is actually probably more important. So, maybe it's not more important, but I think we can all agree in this room that weight isn't directly associated with diabetes risk. I think. So diabetes, type 2 diabetes, despite being incredibly common, I don't think we always appreciate how devastating of a condition it could be, particularly when it's not controlled. It lowers life expectancy by 15 years. It increases your risk of heart disease 2 to 4 times. 2 to 4 times. It is the leading cause of kidney failure, non-traumatic lower limb amputations, adult onset blindness. Okay, all those things are terrible health conditions, which are very, very expensive to treat, which have extremely negative impacts on quality of life. And you can come out with all the numbers you want. You know, it's like $245 billion in the year 2012. It's costing us numbers that we can't even begin to fathom. But I want to break this down at a more fundamental level. And if you're a payer, if you're an employer, you have a small company, you got 35 people in that company, and you're paying their health insurance. These numbers are very, very real. Someone without diabetes, generally healthy, $2,000 a year in premiums. Someone with pre-diabetes, closer to $5,000 a year in premiums. Someone with diabetes is going to cost you $10,000 a year. And that is not complicated diabetes. That's straight, clean diabetes. If your employee has diabetes with complications, it's $20,000+ a year. Year after year after year after year after year after year. In my other life, this is what I do for a living. I help companies deal with their diabetes costs. And what's so, so interesting about it, if you look at the line item diabetes, it actually doesn't add up to that much in terms of costs. But when you pull those diabetics out, and you look at all the costs around proton pump inhibitors, around heart disease, around hypertension, around dyslipidemia, around joint issues, that's where the costs come from. The actual diabetes doesn't necessarily cost them that much. It's all the things it leads to that cost them an enormous amount of money. I think, I don't want to make numbers up, so we'll keep moving. This to me is an example. And I want to make the point, we did ourselves a bit of a disservice when we were selling wellness to employers. Because we were selling cardiovascular disease wellness. And what we were pretty much doing was promoting very expensive medications, statins, to reduce cholesterol, to prevent a stroke or heart attack, which wasn't going to happen while this employee works for this company. So the employers have got very suspicious of all things wellness. Diabetes is different. When your employee converts to diabetes, to type 2 diabetes, it's costing you now. The cardiovascular model wasn't costing you now for most individuals. Diabetes, it costs you now. Diabetes is one of the few places where you can show an ROI around wellness, and I mean a real ROI, despite what we often hear people talking about. So I think we can agree that diabetes causes a lot of suffering and costs a lot of money. And just it's best to be avoided. Or if they have it, we want to reverse it. This is a really, as complicated as this chart is, it's a very important message. And this came out about a year ago too, and this is, what is it, the American Academy of Clinical Endocrinologists. And all this chart is saying is we just can't look at weight alone to determine treatment. You just can't put someone on a scale and determine what the best treatment for them is. What you need to do is take the clinical conditions and cross that by the weight. And that determines the treatment. Someone with a BMI of 32. But no metabolic abnormalities. Let's talk about exercise. Let's talk about healthier diet. Let's not be talking about bariatric surgery. Someone with a BMI of 32, but type 2 diabetes, uncontrolled hypertensive, hemoglobin A1C of 11. Let's talk about medications. Let's talk about surgery. You just can't talk about weight when you're figuring out what somebody's treatment plan needs to be. It has to be weight crossed by clinical condition. I want you to keep that in mind as we go through these slides, because I'm going to show you some different treatment plans. They're not for everybody. It's not one size fits all when it comes to good obesity weight loss management. This is my obesity pyramid. I certainly didn't invent it, but I think it's a nice way to summarize the options available to us, because what I see is whether it's employers or individuals, they like to grab onto one of these, and this is it. This is the one treatment they're going to use for everybody in their program or everybody in their company, and that doesn't make any sense. So the bottom of the pyramid is behavioral based. Let's bring in some good behavioral training to improve diet, increase physical activity. The next level is prepackaged foods, either liquid diet or packaged foods. Why? Because we are horrible at portion control. When you add portion control on top of a behavioral program, you're going to essentially double the weight loss. You're doing two interventions. Medications, I'm going to talk about. Why am I going to talk about medications? Because there are two new medications on the market which are highly effective, and many people in this room have not even heard of because they don't do any direct-to-consumer marketing. There's going to be a third that comes out in June. And yes, I think they're an important part of the toolbox for the clinician. Lastly, surgery. And I'll save my comments for surgery for when we get there. Note, it's a pyramid. They build on each other. And most of the people are going to be at the base of that pyramid. You guys have seen this one 1,000 times, but it's a great example of a behavioral intervention done right. Diabetes prevention program, over 3,000 people with diabetes. One of three groups, either placebo or metformin, or lifestyle modification. That's important. Lifestyle modification. It was not just a pure weight loss study. It was increased physical activity, reduced caloric intake, follow up almost 3 years. One of the points that's so important about this study that John made so nicely yesterday is they had a lot of weight loss after year one, but by year four, the average weight loss is only 4%. Great job of maintaining lifestyle over the course of the study, not just a weight study. And this is what they saw. In the placebo group, 11 out of each 100 individuals converted to diabetic. 11 out of each 100 individuals. In the metformin group, just short of 8 individuals per 100 converted to diabetes. And in the lifestyle group, it was less than 5. What that translates into is the lifestyle group had essentially a 60% lower risk with a whopping 4% weight loss and being physically active. This to me is an example, and we're seeing it, thank goodness, of a program that needs to be disseminated and pushed out there aggressively because it can help people and prevent the progression of diabetes. An example, this was a really nice secondary analysis they did where they actually looked at weight loss. It's in kilograms, you can just convert that to percent. And if you lose no weight, your risk of diabetes is 12.5. If you lose 5%, your risk goes down to 5. You lose 10%, your risk goes down to 2. Some is good, more is better when it comes to diabetes prevention. Some is good, more is better. And then it starts to flatten out at 10 plus. That's why we often say 5 to 10% weight loss, we prefer closer to 10. More is good, some is better. You know, you're seeing YMCAs are rolling this out. CDC tested this. Now there's a YMCA program. A classic example of a place where the right payer could pay for their employees to go do this, to offer their employees a fantastic data-supported program. Medications, and I purposely didn't use any medication names because I do not want to be perceived as pushing any specific medication, though I do believe these things have a role. This is a medication that's been on the market almost 2 years now, a year and a half, doesn't matter. Control group was not a control group. Control group actually got the LEARN program. So the control group had about 3% weight loss, which you will often see in a good behavioral program. Recommended dose of this particular medication, 18 pounds of weight loss or just short of 8% weight loss, and top dose, 22 pounds of weight loss or just short of 10 pounds. Remember, these are FDA trials, So the analysis is extremely rigorous. If anybody ever showed up and shook anybody's hand, they go into this analysis, even if they dropped out at day one. So these are the most conservative views on the weight loss. The bottom line is it worked. And I don't want to go into it. Not only did it work, but these are two medications which have been on the market for decades and have been proven safe. And for some individuals, they extended it out over 2 years. You don't see that traditional Nike swoosh of the weight coming back up. Look at how they, I've had people turn the lights off on me, but not turn them on me. Look at how they keep the weight off at 2 years. At 2 years, the top dose was maintaining more than 10% weight loss, and the mid dose about close to 10%. And I think this is important, because I hear people say all the time, well, does that mean they're going to be on it forever? You would never take someone off their hypertension medication or their diabetes medication. This is a chronic condition. And you might not keep them on this dose. You might lower this dose, or you might take it off altogether, but you're going to come in with some behavior. You're going to come in potentially with some LCDs. This is a chronic condition. This is not lose the weight and life goes on all is grand. We have to rethink how we address weight in the clinic. So yeah, there will be some people who are on some dose for a long time if it's maintaining this weight loss. So the weight loss is one thing, but what does that translate clinically? This was a sub-analysis they did. They took individuals with metabolic syndrome and they looked at how many of them converted to diabetes. And what you see, remember, the placebo group that got the LEARN program at 3% weight loss, their annual conversion rate was 6 people per 100 to diabetes. The two medication groups, the weight loss you saw, was 1.5 and 1.3. In other words, less than 2. Huge clinical benefit. Forget about the weight loss. I don't even care about that right now. Huge clinical benefit. You just cut your risk of developing diabetes, whatever that is, 3 times? But remember, this placebo group got a good weight loss program. Pretend we put the DPP control group in there, a group that got nothing, where we would expect, and what we typically see in populations, by the way, 11 individuals per year converting to diabetes. So compare the 1 to 2 people a year to 11 per year. This is true clinical benefit. Now, just to be complete, the DPP program, which is a little bit better, or not a little bit, it's a lot better, than the LEARN program, the way we did it, I should say, in this study. Look at how you get this nice dose response purely between, I shouldn't say, I got to be careful with that. DPP was not pure weight loss. The other two were pure weight loss. There's a lot to learn from these pharmaceutical studies. And the main thing is, or the takeaway I get, is that these people are not starting to exercise. They just don't. That's not why they're there. They're there for the pill. And they lose the weight. And in this instance, we focused on diabetes. But when we focus on blood pressure, we focus on cholesterol, it's very cool to see the dose response between weight loss and benefit. And it's not always there. Blood pressure is kind of an all or nothing thing. Triglycerides, glucose, dose response with weight loss. So I think we have to kind of take into account what outcome variable are we looking at. And there's a lot to learn from these peer weight loss studies. We've learned a lot from our peer exercise studies. Now, the oh-so-fun surgery. And I'm going to say this sentence probably multiple times. The right surgery and the right patient for the right reasons by the right doctor in the right hospital at the right price can save lives. The more those links in that chain you break, the more likely there is to be a catastrophe of we can all name. We've all been there. We get it. But when used right, it changes lives. And this is an example. This is also a New England Journal paper. They took individuals with type 2 diabetes. It was a 2-year program. One group got an intensive behavioral program. The other got gastric bypass surgery. This was the weight loss. Typically what you see with bypass surgery is 1/3 weight loss. you lose one-third of your weight. It's a good general rule of 2 years. They did, 33.4%, 0.8% weight loss, 106 pounds. Really good behavioral program. 18 pounds of weight loss, about 5% at 2 years. So they did their job for the control group. This is remission of diabetes. Remember, everybody entered the study with diabetes. The behavioral group, not one individual did their diabetes reversed. The surgery group, 75% of individuals reversed their diabetes. Is it permanent reversal? Probably not. I don't think we know how many of these individuals 10 or 15 years from now will revert back to their diabetes, but I think it's hard to argue that 10 or 15 years without diabetes is not a good thing. I'd like to add on top of this was bypass. Bypass is the most expensive of the surgeries and the highest risk of the surgeries. The sleeve surgery has changed this whole dynamic. It is one of the cheaper surgeries, ranging between $14,000 to $15,000, $14,000 to $18,000 a year, if properly negotiated. It is the lowest risk of the surgeries. It gets the weight loss of bypass, and it appears to get the same diabetes reversal rates of bypass. Once again, right surgery, right patient, right doctor, right hospital, and good things happen. Dallas is the mecca of that done wrong. You drive down I-75 and sign after sign after sign after sign. This to me is exactly how you use it. We already know the story, how the story is going to end on a type 2 diabetic that's not controlled. And the end of the story is not going to be pretty. This is an opportunity for them to change their lives for the better. All that said, none of these things, medications, packaged foods, or surgery, are optimized unless they're on the foundation of physical activity. This is a phenomenal study published by Tom Wan in the New England Journal, the same medication to three different groups. One group got medication only, one group got medication with a little bit of behavior, probably what you see in your typical doctor's office. One group got medication plus intensive behavioral therapy, a lot of physical activity. Same medication, three different groups. Note how double the weight loss when you have a good supportive behavioral program behind it, of which physical activity is a cornerstone. So despite as valuable exercise and medications and prepackaged foods are, they're even more valuable, in this case twice as valuable, when done on a backdrop of promoting physical activity and healthy eating. We can never forget that. This is a huge opportunity for all the people in our space. Brett Goodpasture and John Jakasik are light years ahead of the rest of us in terms of taking advantage of this. There's a lot of opportunity here. So, can we all agree that there are weight loss strategies that reduce the risk of diabetes, and in some cases even reverse diabetes? This is where we're at. I think we all agree so far. Weight is directly associated with diabetes. Diabetes is, type 2 diabetes is a bad thing. There are ways to either prevent it or reverse it. So why don't we pay for these treatments? It's mind-numbing to me that we'll pay for the heart attack, we'll pay for the stroke, we'll pay for the hypertension, we'll pay for the diabetes, but we won't pay for things that prevent this stuff. And one of the arguments in the past has been, well, it's not a disease, we're not going to pay for it. Unless it's a disease, we're not going to pay for it. There is my argument. If it takes calling obesity a disease to get it paid for, so we can help lots and lots and lots of people, I'm in. I get it. I get there's all kinds of dirty laundry that comes with that. But I'm in, because there's a whole bunch of people out there who aren't getting the treatment they need because their condition is not a disease. And my wife says, well, now you're giving them an excuse. Yeah, well, maybe, I don't care. I just want them to have options available to help themselves if they so desire to help themselves. That's why I think declaring obesity a disease to increase reimbursement, I'm all for it. We've seen major movement in the last year around that. We're going to continue to see more movement around it. I don't think it's a free-for-all. I don't think you say surgery for everybody. That's not how it works. There has to be systems in place. I help develop such systems, and I think we're getting there. All that said, I think obesity has opened the door for physical inactivity. And it's our job to step through that door. Step back and think about this. If obesity wasn't able to be declared a disease and get reimbursed, one of the most favorite topic of Americans, how are we ever going to get inactivity to that same place? So the door is open. I think this is a good thing. Success leaves clues. What can physical activity folks learn from the obesity folks? These are my observations. I was very fortunate. I know a lot of the people involved in this. This was a long, long fight. This did not start last year or 2 years ago or 3 years ago. They have been chipping away at this. There was lots of partners at the table. And what I observed to be so interesting was it wasn't the players you thought. It wasn't the pharmaceuticals who were leading the charge. It wasn't the surgery device people leading the charge. They were at the table, but there was other partners I would have never expected who were even louder. But it was a lot of partners. They did a phenomenal job of creating coalitions. Constant lobbying. Ruthless. Not once a year, not a few times a year. They got people in Washington hammering away all the time. Unified voice. My opinion, when I was sitting in NIH study sections and I watch an exercise person beat up another exercise person application, it drove me freaking nuts. Because other groups don't do that. And we do. And there's a difference between creative or constructive criticism and helping someone make a stronger grant. But blowing someone up just because it's not exactly your favorite topic, but it's your general area, doesn't make any sense to me, and we are horrible at this. And especially in today's funding environment, if it makes sense and it's fairly well constructed, give them a chance. I see the obesity people do this. I've seen other groups do this. We don't do this. We need a unified voice, not only around the granting mechanisms, but also in what we want when we go lobby this stuff. Focus on billable medical conditions. The life study just handed you a giant softball. We just lobbed this softball up for you guys to knock it out of the park. Get people doing a little bit of physical activity, and you can prevent long-term disability by 28%? Give me a break. That's better than statins and heart disease. Target billable conditions. Dementia, disability, rehab. Don't bring it in there with these esoteric, complicated arguments. Bring it in there as, hey, we can reduce the number of Medicare patients that fall and break their hips every year. Find a clinical condition. What to do next is an exercise person at a research level. This is going to sound crazy, but partner with obesity people. My experience has been, and when I went to Pennington, I thought, oh my gosh, all these people are going to hate me. They're all obesity people. I'm an exercise person. And it's like, you know, Hatfields and McCoys. And it was the opposite. They wanted an exercise person to work with. And I work with obesity people all around the U.S. They want to work with exercise people. They just don't know any often. Partner with obesity people on their grants to incorporate physical activity into their obesity grants. Sometimes to spin it off on your own. Okay. 25 minutes? Great. Couch the exercise questions within obesity questions. There's so many opportunities out there to just spin the grant. So it's a weight grant instead of an obesity. I'm sorry, a weight grant instead of an exercise grant. It's all about selling it. It's the same damn question. You're getting the same data. You just got to spin it a little bit. Sometimes take your wonderful exercise question, but sell it as a weight question. I already mentioned this. All obesity treatments benefit from exercise. We don't understand the mechanisms. We don't understand the dose response. There's such an opportunity here. Lastly, we are talking about either weight loss or comorbidities. Mechanisms of weight loss and exercise. Dive in. What are the common mechanisms? What are the unique mechanisms? What's exercise better for? What's weight loss better for? Summary, In context of striving to do the most good for the most people, declaring obesity a disease may help millions of people get the medical help they need. There are many lessons to be learned from the long fight that was undertaken to get obesity where it is. As exercise professionals, I believe we should embrace this decision, learn from it, and ultimately take advantage of it. Well, that's it. Thank you very much.
I'm not sure if there's something going on in this room next, but they can kick us up when they want to. But if you do have a question, there's a microphone here.
I'm Jim Wang from Minnesota. I'm not impressed by weight loss studies that go out a year or two. I've been in practice 30 years, and my experience, I think, mirrors what's in most of the literature, that people just don't maintain this weight loss long term. And if they do through intensive interventions like the Look Ahead trial, it doesn't result in endpoint benefits. And so I think our unified voice, you know, should be, you know, promoting fitness and lipids, blood sugar, blood pressure, and those things. And I guess when I follow the money, I see this $100 billion weight loss industry that I think is overselling what it can deliver.
So I don't disagree with you with the obesity industry at all. But that's not who we're targeting here. And that's, to me, it's taking advantage of individuals who don't have medical options. I would completely disagree, and we can set up a symposium next year to debate Look Ahead. I think it was a tremendous success. You look at what happened in the control group, it represents what's going on in America since year 2000. Year 2000, the average diabetic's hemoglobin A1C was 7.7, 2007 to 7.0. They're all on statins. They're all having their blood pressure controlled. There's been a great victory in America about diabetics and cardiovascular disease, which no one wants to celebrate. So I think Look Ahead was actually a remarkable victory. But, you know, that was in the prevention of cardiovascular disease. They kept weight off of those individuals for, what, 11 years? 11 years. So I don't buy the Look Ahead argument. They already got diabetes anyway. We didn't reverse their diabetes. We're talking about reversing diabetes. I spent most of my time talking about preventing diabetes. There's just no two ways about it. If we prevent diabetes, good things are going to happen. It's hard as hell. I'm not going to say it's easy. That's why we need all these tools. And behavior within the clinic is a challenge.
Rebecca Wynn, Baton Memorial Institute. Thank you so much for your passion. Thank you. Appreciate it. You made some interesting comments about wellness programs, and I wonder if you would share your opinions on outcomes-based incentives.
Oh my God, really? So outcomes-based incentives are interesting because that whole game has changed. It used to be fun, now it's not. Now it's we're going to double your insurance premium. So what happens, it's going to have to happen now that lawyers are going to get involved and we're going to really upset people, is we're going to have to make sure our outcomes are rock solid. I love to give this example. I consulted with a company recently who had four outcomes for their annual. Their four outcomes were total cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, and LDL to total ratio. And they were using that to determine people's annual premiums. And so I think outcomes is where it's going, but I think we also have to be much better in how we structure these outcomes. Thank you.
Jim Whitehead, University of North Dakota. Enjoyed the presentation, enjoyed the passion, but I'll make the same comment as I made in the energy balance session this morning. It'd be very much appreciated, I think, if we people in this area could stop conflating weight with fatness and body composition. I can guarantee you, if you work with, say, middle school kids or young high school kids, you can get them on an exercise program, especially if you include resistance training, they will gain weight. Their body composition might change radically. But we have this evangelical, since you talked about religion, notion in this country, the holy grail of healthcare recruitment is lose weight. It's not. It's change body composition, especially through healthy methods like eating more sensibly and exercising more sensibly. So please, please cut the lose weight, evangelical message.
So noted.
All right. One quick one.
Hey, Michael Zordos, Florida Atlantic University. First, I just want to say thanks for your time. I really enjoyed your presentation. and really passionate the last two questionnaires asked and talked about. I just want to touch base on one slide that was kind of in the middle of the talk, and it looked at the steady state of type 2 diabetes up to about 1996, and it really took off. And you noted that you thought the curve would actually get steeper. And I was like, man, I didn't think it could. That's crazy. That's not good at all. And so then you said that those entering adulthood would probably be worse off because the curve would get steeper. And I thought that was a great point. And I guess the last questioner touched on this a little bit, but I wanted to say, if that is so, and I do agree, do you think, how do we combat this then? If that is the case, we should then maybe address the kids. And if so, who needs to be the agent of change? Is it the kids themselves? Is it the parents? Is it indulgent parenting? Is it the teachers? And how is that from, what is it, WIC programs? I'm not sure. So what do you think the agent of change would be in there? So,
yeah. I think that's actually a fantastic point. I think the other point earlier, the previous individual said the same thing. You know, I specifically didn't talk about kids, and I had a slide earlier that said adult only, because you start talking about kids, Peter's going to do that next year with one of the most incredible studies you've ever done across 12 countries. I actually think we're making, I got to be careful, I don't know anything about kids, except I got to them. And I think we're making a difference in kids right now because of the awareness around the parents, personally. I think all these campaigns and all this noise we made is waking up the parents. I think that has to be on top of a backdrop of change within school around physical activity and other things. But I think your points are well taken. But Peter needs to answer the kid questions, not me. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much for attending, and thank you, Dr. Church. Thank you.